So we're going to talk about all things New York in a moment. Nearly everyone says it's their number one city in the world, don't they? New York. And it certainly is mine. But I feel like, you know, the ship sailed for me in terms of living in New York, you know, because I think you need to live there when you're in your 20s, when you can be poor and energetic and just don't care. But you can't really live there in your 30s when you're a bit like cranky and a bit older. It's certainly not in your 40s. So I feel like there's this perfect window for when you can live in New York and be uncaring about it and just let the city kind of get under your skin and just go with the flow of the brilliance of New York City. So yeah, I will never live in New York City. But I'm going to get as close to that as possible now, because we're going to talk to Lizzy Goodman, the author of an amazing book called Meet Me in the Bathroom, which chronicles a scene that evolved in New York between 2001 and 2011 with bands like The Strokes, Yeahs, LCD Sound System, Interpol, Vampire Weekend. So yeah, let's see if she's there. Lizzy, hello.
Hello.
Hello, this is Cillian here.
Hey, how are you?
I'm fine, how are you?
I'm good.
Thank you so much for taking the time.
Oh, please. Thank you. It's an honor.
Well, likewise. I absolutely loved your book. And I've just been kind of banging on relentlessly to everybody about it, saying, you got to read this book.
Aww. So I have you to thank for the fact that it's done well in the UK. Thank
probably 100%.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
No. It's just a brilliant book to give to music fans, you know, certainly people of my vintage, you know, who grew up with that music.
Thank you, genuinely. And it's such a thrill to have. Like, it really is bizarre and amazing, as you know, when people respond to something that you care about and made. And obviously, I'm a fan of all these bands deeply, and they shaped my life. So it's been really gratifying to see how many other people feel that way.
Can I ask you a few questions just about how the book came about and how you managed to get access to all these people? And so I remember from the book that, you know, you kind of knew the Strokes before they were, you know, the biggest rock band in the world, that you kind of knew them from around the scene and in New York. Is that correct?
That is correct. Yeah. It's funny. I'm obviously in New York right now, and I live upstate now. I don't live in the city anymore full time. Mm-hmm. And, every time I come here, because there's that distance, there's these sort of ghosts of my past that seem to pop out of random street corners. And I think I just walked by one of the many kind of depressing office park type areas where Nick, one of the guitarists in the Strokes, mm-hmm. and I used to like duck behind planters and smoke weed when we were 19. So it's all, you know, coming back to me now. I mean, my story is kind of, I grew up in New Mexico and kind of had this sort of romantic sense of New York City as a promised land of personal discovery and freedom and danger in the beautiful way. And when I came east for college and I was in Philadelphia, and I would come up to New York pretty often. And my first summer in between school years, I worked in a restaurant kind of near Grand Central Station in Midtown Manhattan, and Nick was also working in that restaurant, and he was just this sort of, you know, lanky city kid, and I'd never really met that type. This kind of creature of the city was, it's now a type I know well, but at the time I was like, what are these people? Like, who, where did this human come from? And where did his friend, like, they were my age, but they were like, they seemed quite wise and kind of swaggery, like characters in a film about street gangs or something like that. So that was the beginning. And he was in this band called The Strokes. And at that time, they were just kind of my friend Nick's band.
Right. And then obviously you were around as his band, and then obviously other bands just became huge and so important at that time. You know, when people talk about, oh, that was a scene, like, you know, Manchester at that time, or Laurel Canyon or Motown, I imagine that people who were living in that scene, you don't have that sort of self-awareness or objectivity to go, wow, we're in the scene. I mean, I imagine that was was how it felt. Or maybe I'm wrong. Maybe you knew.
No, you're not wrong. I think the most important thing to note about this era that I was sort of lucky enough to kind of accidentally fall into and be around for is that it was not special. I mean, of course it was. Like, it turned out to be special, and these artists that happened to be the ones that were in New York during that period of time and what they would come to make is incredibly special. Obviously, I believe that. But in the moment, you're not like, wow, we're going to be written about. And, you know, I mean, if you had told me when I was 20 and taking the commuter trains for 3 hours from Philadelphia to New York so that it would cost $15 so that I could get there, and, you know, I would have money left for like a bagel in the morning after drinking all night at some bar that I was too young to get into. Like, if you had told me that that night would be one that I was going to be asked to recall at any point in the future. That would have seemed absolutely absurd. And I think, you know, it took 6 years to assemble this insane thing that I decided to write. And one of the things that would keep me going when I was making it, and it felt like really unwieldy and kind of impossible to ever succeed in executing, was that I would go and speak to Paul Banks from Interpol, or Julian from the Strokes, or, you know, Nick Zinner from Yeah Yeah Yeahs, or James Murphy. And some of these people didn't even really know each other, but they would all say exactly what you just said. They would all say, I was just trying to make music that wasn't horrifying, because I felt like music was horrifying. And I, without fail, that was, you know, a version of the answer everyone gave to why they felt animated to start the thing that they were making. And the two prongs were like, I didn't like anything, and I didn't think anyone would ever care. So I felt free to do what I wanted. And that's how a scene is built. And all scenes are like that. I don't want to waste your time.
That was The Strokes and Under Control from their second album, Room on Fire. And I'm talking to Lizzy Goodman, who is the author of the book called Meet Me in the Bathroom, Music in New York between 2001-2011. Can I ask you about the form of the book? Because it's this oral history approach that you took, which is so gratifying, I think, for the reader. You feel like you're earwigging on a conversation rather than being sort of sold a thesis on something, if you know what I mean. And I just wonder, how did you settle on that approach? And then also, how did you convince everybody, first of all, to be involved, and secondly, to be so unbelievably candid?
So I think actually the two answers are connected. I mean, the Bible for this is Please Kill Me, which does the same thing for 70s. I mean, I'm copying them. Uh-huh. It's like, we all read that. All the people in this book worshipped the 70s New York City rock scene, if not before they moved here, by the time they kind of got into that music. So to do a Please Kill Me for our era was kind of the aim. And to your second question, I mean, the benefit of that is that there is no truth, right? I mean, it's inherently contradictory, which is how life actually feels. And it's one of the ways that I got people to tell me so much stuff, because, you know, a lot of people said no at the beginning, and you can kind of follow up and be like, hey, you don't have to talk to me about that fight you had with your bandmate that everyone knows about. You just have to tell me about, like, what your favorite bar was in, you know, 2002 and why, and like what you would always play on the jukebox.
What am I right in saying that if one person agrees, who's a significant player in that scene or is a member of a band, and then the other person will go, oh, well, then if they're doing it, maybe I'll do it. And then does that have a bit of a domino effect, or people have a bit more of, you know, reassurance about opening up if you can say, well, look, so-and-so has also just told me this. Was there a bit of that, or is that too manipulative?
Well, I was going to say yes, but now I'm like, oh, I don't want to say I'm a manipulative journalist.
Use a different word.
Okay, right. I'm the writer in this situation. I should be able to come up with a less upsetting synonym. The tactic of being able to say, hey, I'm going to go and try to talk to everyone, and you guys participate or don't, and those who do want to have their say, and those who don't will not have their say. And like, I'm not going to force you, and I only want people to participate if they want to participate. That's all true. That having been said, like, yeah, when you know that everyone you have known and grown up with is talking, like, once I hit a certain saturation point of having enough people, then it was much easier, and there was a domino effect. The best example of this is that Tim Goldsworthy, who was James Murphy's partner, obviously, in the kind of founding of DFA Records, like, the DFA world was probably the only one in this book that I had never had any, like, I never knew those guys from back in the day, and I never wrote about them. So DFA was like the only big sort of force that I had no connection to. And they also, I mean, I could not get them on the phone. I couldn't get them to return my emails for years. And then I found Tim, and I went to England to interview him, and, you know, suddenly my emails got returned, because they obviously, as you've read the book, there's, you know, some contentious stuff between those guys.
To say the least.
So yeah, that is how it works.
And it feels, when you're reading it, particularly about that relationship and some of the stuff that went on, kind of, you know, like with the Strokes and Ryan Adams and stuff. And you're really going, you know, it feels like you're watching stuff disintegrate and you're going, no, guys, just come on, just give them a call or be friends. Or like you get really, really invested, you know, and you've also got the music on in a playlist in the background while you're reading the book. Well, I certainly did. And so it's, you get really emotionally invested in these stories. They become like characters in them. In
oh,
a
good.
Drama, well, certainly for me, you know. And also, just a sort of genesis of LCD Sound System, how James Murphy sort of arrived at that sound, and when he had that magical night taking ecstasy and had this epiphany, you know, like that, you go, oh my goodness, you know, don't do drugs, but like that's that's fantastic. Sort of go, oh, that's how that sound arrived. That's how that beautiful mixture of styles that band has. That's, there you yeah. go. Ah, now that makes sense. You know?
Oh, good. Yeah, so. That's a fun, when you get a story like that as a journalist, you're just like, I'm opening champagne tonight. Like it just feels, you're just like, I'm sorry, what? Like, what are you telling me? And then it just feels really, that was fun.
Well, thank you so much, Lizzy, for taking the time. That was really amazing. Everyone should go and read the book immediately.
My personal hype man. It's an honor to have you in that role.
No, it's really great. And, you know, everyone who was around at that time and listening to that music will go back and listen to those records again. And I'm going to play some now on the radio.
Thanks so much for supporting it and for having me on. And it's a thrill to talk to you about this. I'm glad you liked it so much.
Likewise. Have a great day, Lizzy.
Thank you.
Take care.
You too.
Bye.
Bye. Well, I shuffled through the city on a 4th of July. I had a firecrack waiting to blow. Breaking like a rival who was making his way to the cities of Mexico. Living in an apartment out on Avenue A. Had a tall on a corner of town. Had myself a lover who was finer than gold. But I've been broken, I've been busted up since. Love don't play any games with me anymore like she did before. The world won't wait, so I bet she that thing right out there through the door. Hell, I still love you, New York.
That was Ryan Adams at New York, New York. One of the great songs about New York. There is a long list of fantastic songs about New York. And Ryan Adams features in this book that I've just been speaking about. And you get so invested emotionally in that story of Ryan Adams and the Strokes. It's kind of amazing. But listen, if you get that music out of it, then it seems like it was worth it.